Okay, my name is Taghi Farvar. I'm an Iranian Azerbaijani descendant of Shasavan nomads, nomadic tribes. And formally, I guess, I'm the chair of a non-governmental organization, a civil society organization in Iran called Senesta, Center for Sustainable Development, and also president of an international conspiracy called ICCA Consortium. Sounds like a conspiracy, no? ICCA is Indigenous Peoples Conservation Territories and Community Conserved Areas. It's actually the areas that local communities and Indigenous peoples have conserved throughout time for centuries and thousands of years. My particular ancestors, I think, conserved nature before they descended from the tree. And I'll have a chance to refer to that a bit in my talk. So I guess we can just start and then see where we go. Okay, this is roughly, I guess it's a warped aspect ratio on the screen, but it doesn't matter. Maybe up there it's better. A few pictures of Iran. Up there is the general locality of Iran. And down below there's three different maps. One is sort of bioclimatic map. Another, the middle one, is the map of the topographic map. And on the left, a few of the what we call the territories of nomadic pastoralists in Iran, a few of them that we made a few years ago. We were working with a group of these, but there's altogether something like 700 tribes and tribal confederacies of indigenous nomadic pastoralists in Iran. And this, in our view, are the indigenous peoples of Iran. They number the mobile ones, the migratory ones, seasonal migration, number something like 1.5 million. Interesting that throughout time, if you go back, say, a couple of centuries ago, you'll find that perhaps there are estimates that a half or more, maybe two-thirds of the population were nomadic pastoralists. And these days they're only 2% of the population roughly. However, their absolute numbers haven't really changed. They've always stayed dynamically constant around the mean, depending on climatic conditions, rangeland circumstances, and so forth. There's this tremendous resilience and stability to the population of nomads, so that excess populations that the land cannot carry gradually leave the system and go to cities or villages and to other lowlier types of existence, like become university professors or cigarette salespeople or whatever you can think of. So the most important thing is that these indigenous nomads all have territories, and because they depend on migration, and because Iran, as you can see, is a country with a lot of differences in altitude, much of the migration in Iran is what's called vertical seasonal migration, whereas in much of Africa and parts of Iran, such as in the southeast, we have horizontal migratory peoples. The difference being that in the vertical one, in the summertime, when it's the heights, the tops of mountains and so forth are cooler, nicer, more grass, more water. They migrate up the hills, and when the winter comes, they go down to the valleys and the plains that are low-lying, therefore they're warmer, and there they find more conveniently grass and water and things that they need for their pastoral existence. And the entire territory of summering grounds, wintering grounds, way stations, the tribal migratory routes, together we call it territory of a people, of a nomadic tribe, sub-tribe, tribal confederacy, which is the highest level when a group of tribes are federating and related to each other. And throughout time, the basis of governance in Iran, political governance, has been nomadic pastoralists who where a number of tribes would come together, federate, and then they take power and keep it as a new dynasty for several generations until they would be urbanized and corrupted and become womanizers and manizers and whatever, and they would then fall and another confederation of tribes would take over. That was the case until the Shah's father, through a British-supported conspiracy, coup d'etat, came to power in 1921, I think it was. I have much more of an authority on Iran, who's Dr. Navidi, a very old colleague of mine, who was in London, and he came along to get to know you folks and to listen. So that went on, and then over the past, say, century, since early this century, early last century, we've had a lot of things happening to the nomadic pastoralists, whether they are camel herders or herding other animals or a composition of animals which includes camels very often. And there was the Constitutional Revolution of 1906, which essentially, as far as we can tell from the impact, its main job was that it ushered in modern capitalism. And this went on when Reza Shah came to power, the Shah's father, because the tribal peoples in Iran were the main impediments through fighting to British takeover of Iran as a colony. They hated nomads, and so the policies they instilled and inspired or directed with the new king was absolutely anti-nomadic. So at gunpoint they settled them. However, my view is that over the past three political regimes that we've had in Iran, the Shah's father, the Shah, and the current so-called Islamic regime, their nomadic policies have been the same. It has equaled the word sedentarization by whatever name in Persian or local languages, and only the instrument, the weapon by which they have tried to sedentarize nomads has changed. Reza Shah, the Shah's father, used the bullet as a weapon. The Shah, being supported by the Americans, was much more sophisticated. He used the chalk instead, nomadic schools that would even migrate with the nomads, tent schools, which was a wonderful thing, and it received a UNESCO prize for that. However, the content was designed in order to absolutely alienate the nomadic kids to their way of life and to get them to hate anything about nomadism and so forth. That's what has happened. And then this regime has substituted the bullet and the chalk with the kiss. Maybe a kiss of death, we could call it. You know, you're so wonderful, you nomads, you keep the country together and all this, and what a pity you're living such a primitive life, so civilized, you know, and they've spent a lot of money, much more than anything before, to sedentarize them. And before I get into this very quickly, I'll tell you that back 20 years ago, 21 years ago, at the time of President Rafsanjani, all of you have heard of him, he was chairing a session of the High Council of Nomadic Affairs, which is chaired by the President of the Republic. That would have been 1991, I believe. And he declared to this council that my policy, he said, is sedentarization. don't mention the word, because dirty word in Iran, with a backlog of a lot of negative experiences, deadly experiences in Iran. But he said, this is what I want. And he set a very precise goal. He said, 20 years from now, which would be last year, I don't want a single tent hold, that's the nomadic equivalent of household, to still be migrating. Not a single family, not a single tent hold. And he and subsequent governments, including President Khatami, everybody's darling for two periods, President Ahmadinejad, everybody's devil for two more periods, all of them have put equal, tremendous amounts of money into the sanitarization effort. And I can tell you the net result. In 1991, when President Khatami, Rafsanjani announced his sanitarization policy, which has been followed to the letter up to now through the five-year development plans, there were about 200,000 migratory tent holds of nomads. Last year, when the 20 years were over, there were 220,000. Thank all the goddesses in this world, which I believe in a little bit more than in gods. The nomadic population in terms of tent holds was 10% higher, although the size of tent holds was a bit smaller, like it had come from 5 point something to 4 point something. So roughly the same number of people were nomadic and migrating seasonally, which shows that despite whatever stupid politicians of any color, any religion, any persuasion say, nature, and if anybody still believes in God, in Iran there are very few left, thanks to 30-something years of a supposedly Islamic regime. If anybody still believes in that, they would basically believe that the laws of God are obviously expressing themselves through the laws of nature, and nomads follow the law of nature. Experts believe that nomadism as a way of life started roughly 10 to 12,000 years ago in our region of the world, somewhere between the Zagros Mountains and the Sham Mountains or the Syrian Mountains there, and that the ancestors were hunters and gatherers who depended partly on the ancestors of the current day domesticated animals that we have, and therefore they would follow the animals, and they noticed that these animals are not stupid enough to stay in one place all year round. That when winter starts, they go down the slopes, and when summer starts, they go up. And they learned how to migrate from nature, from these animals. And eventually they domesticated them, and after they domesticated the dog as well, they could form comfortable, good-sized flocks. I don't know if those of you who may have done shepherding, if you do it without a dog and you take out a flock of 500, you're lucky if you come back with 100. And if you have a dog, you'll bring back, chances are, all 500 of them. So then they continued this way of life. And as long as these mountains are there and the lowlands are there, nature and the ecology demands a migratory system of use of these lands, extensive use of these lands through pastoralism. And in fact, these days the government experts, with people with university degrees from anywhere in the world, including Iran, and I've grown to consider, by the way, university degree as a very high level certificate of illiteracy that is given to us. And I'm probably embarrassed to say that I hold one of the highest. I hold the highest degree of certificate of illiteracy. When I got my, I felt that when I got my PhD degree from Washington University in the United States. And after that, I think I had to go to the elders of nomadic tribes and all sorts of other indigenous peoples in order to learn some real literacy and try to forget whatever I'd been taught in school. So they have come up with ways which are imitative of range management, for example. They've come up with something they call range management projects, which is a mistranslation of ranching schemes. Ranching, as you may know, is an idea, is a system of management of animals, which comes from Western United States and Australia primarily. And it is in every way, ecologically, socially, what have you, culturally, totally against everything we have, because our systems are based on migration. So the government will send a consulting firm and maybe get a kickback to design a ranching scheme for a person or a group of people in the highlands, in the summering grounds, and then they'll go home and get their money. And 4 months later, let's say, if you go there, you'll find that there's nothing but snow and avalanches and snowstorms and ice. So nobody, certainly not animals, which are not stupid enough to live in that condition. And yet the government insists you have to settle here and give up the what they call the opposite pole, your wintering ground. So we've been at it for a long time trying to fight these kinds of very stupid, educated plans. And that's also partly what makes me, despite my great respect for Dr. the gentleman from Egypt, who's talking about, I'm sure he's doing a very good work from what I could gather, but I'm an enemy of extension systems. Extension systems are a way of extending the illiteracy and stupid policies of the so-called learned people down to supposedly ignorant nomads and villagers and so forth, and it doesn't work like that. It's probably the opposite that is true. So we've been supporting the work of and the struggle of local communities, indigenous peoples, against this technocracy and against these really very destructive and stupid policies that the government has been having for decades now. And I think we're beginning to see the light at the end of the tunnel and getting somewhere. Okay, let me see if we can just quickly go through some of these and show you a few scenes. This is a part of the migratory route of the Dashkai tribes. The Dashkai are one of the three largest tribes in Iran. There's the Bakhtiari, the Dashkai, the Shahsevan, and a few others. And we're working with all of these. And we believe also that their entire territory of a nomadic peoples is a community conserved area. They conserve it. There are many reasons. The very fact of migration, seasonal migration, is done, if you talk to the elders, primarily in order to conserve nature. Because, as they say, if we mistreat nature, if we don't conserve it one day, the next day it's not going to give us anything to eat. So they're conservers by nature. And such a thing as the IUCN, of which I was a member of the its council and chair of one of its commissions for about 8 years, they have approved a policy in which they accept nomads and nomadic pastoralists, or what we call mobile indigenous peoples, as friends of conservation rather than as enemies. And the second thing is exclusion. The principle of exclusion means I, from my tribe, cannot come into your tribal territories and graze my animals. And that's another important thing in conservation. There's just countless ways in which conservation happens in these. So these are all community conserved areas or indigenous peoples' conservation territories. I'm not going to dwell on all the details of every slide. This is interesting. In the province of Fars, which means Persia proper, Persia and Iran, in the Iranian language, is only one province. The capital of it is Shiraz. The gentleman who was the Director General of Nomadic Affairs declared to us one day that there are no more camels left among the nomadic tribes in my province, and there is no more traditional migration. That means with women and children and men and, you know, going on foot or on animals. And the next day, we went and we discovered flocks of camels. I don't know if in camels we call them flocks also, because camels, as I mentioned yesterday, are counted as people. You know, I said yesterday that humans, camels, and date palms are counted as persons. You know, like how many camels do you see there? And you count them and say there are five persons there. And the ones that least deserve it, as I said, is people to be considered persons. So we found 300 person strong flocks of camels that were migrating, and here they were preparing for migration, men, women, and so forth. And we went back to them and said, you better just take a look, go see the, you know, look at your terms of reference and find out that you don't know your people. And also we migrated for a few weeks with these tent holds, and we covered quite a number of nomadic subdivisions, and there was just masses of traditional migration, meaning with women, children, men, on foot, on animal back, spending nights where men and women have an equal job of protecting the herds. Like maybe they take turns every 2 hours with a gun, men or women equally, and guard against wolves or against thieves. Up there you see, well, without the need to count, you can see a huge herd of these magnificent animals migrating. By the way, one of the things that we found out about the camel is that its red blood cells, unlike any other mammal, are elliptoid, and they're not circular or spherical. And that means in droughts, when the capillary vessels in the body of all the other mammals become so tight that red blood cells cannot go. That's why we, the main reason why we die of thirst. Camels, red blood cells, will still flow because they're elliptical and they just pass through and help the camel have its proverbial resistance to drought. That up there, you probably see other shots of it, is what I have been calling a camel ICCA, a camel protected area. It's the camels that are protecting that region with its plant cover and so forth, because where there are no camels, in fact, these things disappear, the plant cover. So some of the policies that are inconsistent with camel herding have been including these. I don't know if there's time to really go through much of this, but forced or induced sedentarization, special these tent schools, tribal schools that I mentioned, that teach the anti-nomadic cult to the children. We've worked with them and we've seen that happen. Alienation and dispossession of the land under the rubric of so-called land reform and nationalization. In fact, the, much of the pastures and rangelands and forests and so forth were held in common as communal use or property by camel herders as well as other herders alike. And the Shah, in an American-inspired white revolution, he called it, a revolution from the top, he usurped all that and called it national property. So we are dead against both nationalization and privatization of communal lands and territories. But that has been won, and in fact, finally, after a lot of lobbying, after a lot of getting communities and government in touch with each other, it's now possible to do the impossible. 5 years ago, if I talked against the law of nationalization of natural resources, I'd probably be shot. And now, many people in government even are joining us and saying this was a mistake. And its purpose had nothing to do with anything good or positive. And unfortunately, most of the region that I come from, other countries as well, have gone this way of nationalizing rangelands, which I think is a very, very unfortunate and destructive policy. And the answer is not to privatize, but rather to allow it to exist as communal holdings, because that's what's required. Accusation of the camel as destructive of nature and natural resources, which is a total lie. In fact, camels are conservers of deserts. If it weren't for deserts in much of Iran, for camels, the desert would have just taken over much of the land and destroyed it. We don't have time to enter into the details, but I'm sure other experts can talk about it much better than I. If a tendency to favor enclosed or semi-enclosed camel compounds, camel prisons, yes, destocking of livestock populations, transfer of alien techniques, such as I mentioned, the ranching schemes, and so on. So this is one of those camel ICCAs that are not very far from Tehran. There's a whole belt of this, the foothills of the Alborz Mountains in west to east in the north of Iran. A lot of sessions with both local populations and local communities and government agents, and bringing them together, discussing endlessly. But these have been very useful, sometimes discussions in the government's territory, such as in these office buildings, sometimes in the field. That has been very, very useful and has opened up a lot of communication channels. And I'll keep going. Well, interesting, these two ladies were among people that we were interviewing, and they were telling us how they work with camel hair to produce handicrafts. And they were talking about how sacred the camel is in the nomadic culture, that in fact they won't make just anything. They won't make anything that smacks of lack of respect. They will only make things that are useful and respectable and so forth, because the camels are sacred animals to them. Now, up here is the poster for the first camel, for the first National Camel Congress in Iran, which happened a year ago this month in April. And that was very interesting. They probably made the mistake of inviting us as Senesta into the planning group. And we told them right from the very first meeting that we're not alone. If you invite us, we're going to sneak in the camel herders as well, and you'll have to listen to them. And like our friend from Egypt was saying, we have to listen to the communities. And so we began to bring camel herders into the planning process, and then managed to take over for the camel herders, or by the camel herders, a whole part of this scientific congress, which was very unusual. Usually in scientific congresses, community people are not allowed, and they're considered to be too ignorant to come to these august gatherings of gentlemen and ladies that are researchers and scientists and the like. But we managed to get into that congress about 35 camel herders, men and women. And they held, for example, a whole day of a round table when they were presenting and others were listening, the scientists were listening. And on the second day, which was going into the heavy technical stuff, the researchers and all, the organizers brought two buses to take our nomads and camel herders on a tour of the city. This was Mashhad, which is a central pilgrimage, very popular for religious tourism. And the nomads said, what are these for? They said, oh, we're going to take you around. They said, why? We've come to the Congress. They said, oh, you'll get bored. It's all just technical presentations and things. They said, nonsense. We're not moving anywhere. We want to sit here, see what you guys are saying, interact with you, and that's why we're here. And for people who would pay anything to go to a pilgrimage in that city, this was a fantastic thing to resist that. So they sat through every presentation that was made. They would raise their hands, several of them, men and women, and say, hey, this thing you've researched about the camels is wrong. The truth is this and this. And they had so much of this, and they also had an exposition, and people would come and talk to them. By the end, the researchers were coming to the camel herders and saying, please, Would you partner with us? Would you come and direct our strategies for research and all that? Tell us your needs. Let's do the stuff together. So we've managed to quite a bit to democratize camel research and livestock research and even natural resource research through these kinds of means. And okay, again, I'm not going to dwell on too much of the details. It's interesting. In the course of organizing this, a number of our camel herders would say, what happens in a scientific conference? We said, oh, you know, erudite people write first abstracts and then longer papers and make presentations and all that to each other about, you know, facts about whatever the subject, in this case the camel. They said, well, we think we're the best experts on the camel. Can we participate? We said, why not? So we encouraged them. There were about something like 6 or 8 abstracts produced by these people. They're showing off their, you know, their participation things in the camel congress. But here is the first draft of their abstracts for this congress, which were handwritten, and we helped them type it. We sometimes edited so that it would become more understandable by people that have a hard time understanding field realities. And 6 or 8 of them were accepted, and they presented them, and they presented PowerPoints and all of this. And in order to prepare them for this, we organized a 2-day workshop at Senesta, at our center, where they came and learned all about how erudite people organize these things, and they went through their predicament, their priorities, their visions of a desirable future, and the strategy for what to do. And they went to the Congress better prepared than any of the scientists and researchers, and they presented that. And the other thing that they did at the, this is the workshop at Senesta where they're coming up with all the priorities and what have you, and the group of camel herders, including women. I think there were about 8 women of the 30-something, 35, at the Congress itself. Scenes from all this. This guy is from my tribe. He's the head of one of the 32 tribes of the Shastaman, and he is a Bactrian camel specialist and herder as well. And he's trying to prevent their downfall, their degradation, and so forth. The other thing that they decided to do while they got together and organized themselves at Senesta was that they said, look, everybody in this country has professional societies and what have you. Why don't we have one? And we said, there's no reason. We can't organize one. The law allows you to. So they came up with a statutes of something that we now call UniCamel, which is a co-author of this paper. And UniCamel is the union of indigenous camel herders of Iran from all over the country, but as groups, tribal peoples and local communities otherwise that are camel herders and so forth. And in fact, their organization was announced at the Camel Congress, and soon after that it was registered in a small registration bureau, because in Tehran it would have been too complicated to pull off something like this. But now they're a legal entity, and they exist, and they're taken much more seriously in policy discussions and what happened. This is just one scene near one of the camel herding nomadic tribes, and exhibition and so forth. Here are some of the women that are making presentations to the Congress, and some of the achievements, which was fantastic. So these people came together and actually did it. This was a first, and we've done other things since then. For example, at the next national, I get the message, Congress of, you don't need to. Just like we watch a camel and we can learn the science, we can watch you and see the science as well. Only the camel usually brings good messages. Okay. So, but the best best thing that happened, it emboldened, empowered the camel herders that before were ignored and marginalized and really done very bad things upon, committing bestialities. Actually, there's nothing wrong with beasts, is there? And then we took into the next National Congress of Rangelands about 25 nomadic pastoralists, and they just turned the whole thing on its head. And people began to see that they were really missing out on the real science and the real knowledge and so forth. And so I will just try to come to a conclusion. These are the aims of UniCamel. Okay, I think we can just simply call it the end. Thank you.